Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the ELSA webinar on inguinal hernia. So today we have Prof. David Lomanto, as usual, and we have Dr. Vimal from Malaysia. We have Dr. Ghafoor, also from Malaysia, Penang. We have Dr. Rakesh Gupta, who's from Nepal. Then we are going to have Dr. Sajid, who is from Pakistan. So, Prof, can we move on to the slides? Okay, so similar to our previous courses, so we have arranged the inguinal hernia course also in three parts. So today is the first part, which is the lectures. And we move on to our video masterclass. Prof, next slide, please. Prof, next slide. So we will move on to our video masterclass, which is on the 15th, and these are our speakers. So please register for our video masterclass, which will be on the 15th of July. And the next part, or the third part, is similarly, how we all did for the lab college. So please record a video of how you do an inguinal hernia, then you can send to us to complete the course, and they will do an assessment, and then you'll be awarded the certificate. Prof, next slide, please. So all panelists and speakers, please keep the microphone mute when you're not speaking. And all participants are encouraged to ask questions through our chat box, which is a Q and answer chat box. And the moderator will control the flow and the timing of the presentation. And the webinar will be recorded and uploaded on ELSA YouTube channel. So anybody wants to reflect back on the lectures, you all can do. It is also live, telecasted in Facebook. And at the end of the session, there will be two sessions of MCQ, which is 10 minutes each. Prof, next slide. So so those who are interested in joining our Endo-Laparoscopic Surgery Learning Portal, so please scan the QR code, then you will be taken to the website, the web page, and you can register using your email address, and then you'll be given access to go through some of the contents. Okay. Next, please. So these are our proud sponsors, Olympus and Erby. So we are quite happy that we have 525 participants today. Okay, next slide. So please have a look at this video, one of our sponsors, who is Erby. yeah, so I will play the video, then after that we can start the webinar. Prof, can you play the video? So this is the new electrosurgical unit. So this is an important instrument for those who want to use for inguinal hernia. It's called bisect. It's purely bipolar. This is a reusable instrument, so.
Smoke containing potentially hazardous substances is generated during electrosurgical cutting and coagulation of tissue, also in cases of laser and ultrasound applications. The IES3 smoke evacuation system is our solution for a safe and clean working environment. The IES3 filters smoke and odors and extracts aerosol-charged air during open surgical and laparoscopic procedures. For use in the operating room, integrate the IES3 into a VIA workstation or use it as a standalone unit. The IES3 is the universally suitable smoke evacuation system for hospital operating rooms, outpatient facilities, and medical practices. In combination with smoke evacuation pencils, you can cut and coagulate while simultaneously evacuating the resulting smoke. The 5-stage high-efficiency filter removes virtually all particles with diameters of 0.1 micrometers and more. Thus, this filter offers the best possible degree of safety.
Okay, so maybe Gafur, can I invite you to introduce the speakers in order? Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Sujit, and thank you everyone for joining us in today's ELSA OP webinar series for this year. So, as you know, this will be the series for hernia, and to kick things off. We actually have Dr. Sajid Malik from Pakistan, who will be talking to us on anatomy and classification. I think this would be the most abundant questions in the MCQ, so I suggest everyone pays attention. All right. So Dr. Sajid is from Pakistan. I believe he trained with Professor David Lomanto in Singapore for quite some time. And then subsequently, he has returned to Pakistan to work. And it gives me great pleasure to invite Dr. Sajid to present his talk today on anatomy and classification.
I think Sajid is not in. You can move to the next
Prof.
one.
Sajid is here.
Oh, yeah. Oh, he's here. I cannot see. Okay, great.
Thank you, Dr. Rafood. Thank you, Dr. Sajid and Prof for a brief introduction. And can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. For this trilogy of the inguinal hernia, the first series, today I'm going to talk about the anatomy and the classification for this hybrid inguinal hernia repaired for MIS approaches for the inguinal hernia reconstruction. I always acknowledge Dr. Gafur has introduced me. I have worked with Professor Lomanto and learned the technique of TAP and the TAP technique and all the abdominal wall reconstruction from Prof and also from Dr. Sujit. So before going into the details of the anatomy, just couple of slides regarding the what exactly is a groin. Groin is the area of the junction between the anterior abdominal wall and the thigh. The whole area is known as groin. So it has two parts. One is the anterior and the posterior view. If we talk about this like this, if we talk about the inguinal canal, which is formed by exactly the four different structures, and the it is located, everyone knows that it's an oblique passage, 4 centimeter long, located 1.5 centimeter above the medial half of the inguinal ligament. The structures passing through the canal, the various structures, but the major difference in the male and the female is the spermatic cord and the round ligament of the uterus. But when we talk about the laparoscopic groin view, Mr. Little in 1945 said, the operating surgeon knows little of the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. So well is it hidden from the his view. So it's entirely different from the anterior view.
Do we lost Sajid?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah, I think we lost Sajid. Yeah.
But I can't hear him.
Can you let me text him?
Yeah.
I think it disappeared.
Yeah.
Maybe we go to the next talk first.
Yes, you, okay. Rakesh.
So the next talk is going to be on guidelines by Dr. Rakesh Gupta from Nepal. Dr. Rakesh is a very accomplished laparoscopic surgeon hailing from Nepal, and it gives me great pleasure to invite him for his talk. Dr. Rakesh, please.
So good day all of you, and I would like to thank ELSA OP and especially Professor Lomanto for giving me this opportunity. Today I'm presenting the international guideline for groin hernia management. So my slides are visible, Dr. Ghafoor.
Yes.
So if we see by definition, guidelines is a set of standard criteria or specification to be used or followed while performing any clinical task. It evaluates the available option in the current circumstances and suggests the proper solution for any particular problem. And in clinical scenario, it improves our medical quality and effectiveness of management, reduce the variation between physician and all our practices is the evidence-based surgery rather than based on experience or opinion. It provides a holistic standard of clinical practice, and definitely the patient receive benefit in form of having the standard information for his consent. So in the making of guidelines, the literature is searched and evidence are leveled from 1 to 5. Like 1 is a systemic review of randomized controlled trial having homogeneous result in all the RCTs, till 5, which is the expert opinion or experimental study. And from this evidence, the recommendations are given from A to D. A is the high quality recommendation that is based on systemic review and at least 2 RCT. B and C are good or low quality cohort or case control study respectively. D is based on expert opinion or consensus committee opinion. So if we see the such our literature, we have plenty of guidelines. The first was given by European Hernia Society in 2009, followed by International Indo Hernia Society in 2011. And in the leadership of Professor Lomanto, the Asian subcontinent published his guidelines in 2014 under the umbrella of Asia Pacific Hernia Society. And the latest one is the International Guidelines for Groin Hernia Management, which is endorsed by all 5 subcontinental hernia society, plus EAES and IEHS, with a very common goal, that is to improve patient outcome. So if we see the hernia search guideline, it has near about 54 member in its steering committee, and five of this member is from the esteemed surgeon from the Asian subcontinent, including Professor Lomanto. And this guidelines has been divided into 3 parts. This is part 1, which include the management of groin hernia in adult. Then part 2, which has a specific aspect of groin hernia management. Part 3 is the based on the quality, research and global management. So I'm discussing few of this chapter. Like what about the risk factor? When the literature are searched and evidence are collected, the risk factor for groin hernia is labeled as a high, moderate, and low. High is the familial history in the first degree relative, male gender, older age with the direct hernia, and decreased collagen type, like type 1, decreased ratio of type 1 and type 3 collagen, open prostatectomy, obesity are the high risk factor. Moderate is the increased matrix metalloproteinase and rare connective disorder like Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. And lower one is the chronic constipation, tobacco use. So the recommendation for this risk factor given is the acquired surgical and perioperative risk factor, which are potentially modifiable, must be considered when performing any type of repair in the groin hernia. Then second is the diagnostic modality. So what is the best suitable diagnostic modality in the groin hernia? So gold standard, as all we know, is the clinical evaluation with very high sensitivity and specificity. And ultrasound is added when we have confusion, especially in the patient with recurrent hernia. And dynamic MRI and CT is in most of the cases is not required until unless this clinical evaluation and ultrasound is negative or non-diagnostic, especially in the old obese patient or multiple hernia, or when we are considering the clinical occult hernia, or when our diagnosis, we have plenty of other differential diagnosis in chronic groin pain. So what about the classification? I mean, EHS classification is most commonly used in the groin. I mean, there are plenty of classification, but EHS classification is most commonly used is for purpose of performing research, tailoring our treatment, and performing quality audit. I think this part will be discussed by Sajid in some detail. So I am leaving this part. Then what are the indication of treatment for symptomatic and asymptomatic patient? As we all know, there are more than 50 kind of surgery can be performed for groin hernia repair, which is starting from watchful waiting to non-mesh technique to open mesh technique and endoscopic technique. So regarding the watchful waiting in the groin hernia surgery, I mean, the patient with the symptom of groin hernia should not be undergo watchful waiting because chances of complications plus cross over to the surgery from watchful waiting to surgery is 50 to 70% at the follow-up of 7 to 10 year. And even when we consider the watchful waiting, patient must be counseled regarding the higher morbidity and even mortality in the emergency setting. And elective surgery has very low morbidity and mortality. So if we consider the non-mesh technique, so Soldes, I mean, there are plenty of non-mesh technique starting from Bassinis, Soldes, Nisada, but Soldes is the most common studied non-mesh technique. And among other non-mesh technique, it has the least recurrence. So when we choose the non-mesh technique, especially in the younger patient with very small lateral hernia like EHS L1 or L2, or some patient refuse to use the mesh implant. So in this kind of patient or in the country where the resource mesh are not available, a very poor resource country, suture repair are advisable. But this current guidelines which I am presenting is recommended the mesh must be used irrespective of any kind of hernia in all adult male because it's having low recurrence and very less post-operative pain. So what about the open surgery or laparoscopic surgery? So when this question is asked, considered for the literature was served, so the recommendation given was for any male patient with primary unilateral groin hernia, laparoscopic technique is advisable, is suggested because of decreased early post-operative pain and chronic long-term chronic inguinal pain if the surgeon has specific expertise available and sufficient resources are available, because the laparoscopic has the lower incidence of wound infection, lower incidence of hematoma formation, lower incidence of nerve injury, lower incidence of chronic pain syndrome, and early return to activities very fast. Then what about TEP and TAP? I mean, both have similar result. Approaches is different, which my next speaker will going to discuss in detail. When the statement for this is search, what we found is there is no difference in morbidity in the TEP and TAP. TEP is slightly, although very low, but TEP is associated with slightly increased vascular injury, slightly higher conversion rate, and learning curve for TEP is slightly longer in comparison to TAP. TAP the easier to perform, but has very minimal, but slightly higher chance of visceral injury, and there is a slight increased incidence of port site hernia in TAP. So recommendation given for TEP and TAP is choice depend upon the surgeon's skill, education, and his experience. What about individualization of the treatment? Is definitely which surgery to choose for a particular patient? So it's depend upon the surgeon expertise, patient characteristic, hernia characteristic, and in what situation we are operating. So recommendation given is any patient with bilateral hernia, laparoscopic repair is advisable. Any patient having pelvic pathology or any scarring in the pelvis due to radiation or previous post-op patient or having peritoneal dialysis, anterior approach is considerable in this kind of patient. And we should able to tailor our approach based on the our expertise, our resources available, and definitely the patient and hernia characteristic. So in the last, one size doesn't fit for all patient. We need all the surgeons should have should be well versed with the anterior, should know the anterior and posterior approach. So what about the occult hernia? So recommendation given for the occult hernia, like if you are performing the tap repair, we should inspect the contralateral side. And if we find the hernia on the contralateral side, if the prior consent is taken from the patient, repair is recommended in tap, because the development of overt hernia is more than 30% at the 1 year of follow-up. And when we are performing TP, the contralateral exploration of normal groin is not suggested, because definitely the bilateral repair has advantage, because in the obese patient, the clinical accuracy is poor, and definitely it has slight benefit to the healthcare system. Slightly higher operative time than unilateral, but no difference in any morbidity. What about the daycare surgery in the groin hernia? If we see the data in the lower part, in the developed country, more than 50 to 80% of the surgeries performed as a daycare basis, but we need to have adequate aftercare. If it's there, then we can perform, daycare hernia surgery can be performed. Even it can be performed in the complex groin hernia, older patient and patient having ASA grade 3. What about the mesh? What characteristics are important when we consider the mesh? Definitely my next speaker is going to discuss in detail. So a single perfect mesh and single classification, including all the complications, doesn't exist. When we consider mesh, the pore size, effective porosity, type of polymer, weaving of mesh must be considered. A recommendation for 3D mesh is not recommended, because having higher foreign material, and it breaches both anterior and posterior plane. So, and this classification of low and heavy weight mesh is not recommended, because there is no clear cut definition of low and heavy mesh. So hernia surge recommend mesh should be large pore monofilament and having bust and tensile strength in all direction should be at least 16 Newton per meter square. And when we consider low weight mesh, it has only advantage in the early post-operative pain, low early post-operative pain. For the mesh fixation, the recommendation, fixation is not as advisable in TP, except in the patient who is having large direct hernia, that is EHS M3. Even when we choose the fixation, the less is more. Heteromatic kind of fixation in form of fibrillin salient or glue is recommended. What about the antibiotic prophylaxis in the hernia surgery? So patient can be categorized as average risk patient or high risk patient, and setting our surgical environment can be classified as a low risk or high risk environment. So patient who was undergoing bilateral or recurrent hernia repair should be given antibiotic, and average risk patient in the low risk environment, antibiotic is not recommended. High risk patient in low risk environment, antibiotic is suggested. Any patient in high risk setting, antibiotics is recommended. Laparoscopic surgery, antibiotic is not recommended. With this slide, we can see the low risk environment, the antibiotic doesn't make much difference. In high risk environment, definitely adding antibiotic decrease the wound infection by half of its strength. Regarding the anesthesia, local anesthesia can be used in an open surgery with reducible groin hernia, provided that surgical surgeon is sufficient experience in giving local anesthesia. It is a very good tool in the patient having the severe systemic disease. But a word of caution is necessary here. When the literature or rate of recurrence is slightly higher in the patient with the who are undergoing surgery under local anesthesia. What about the postoperative analgesia? I mean, recommendation is NSAID or selective COX-2 inhibitor plus paracetamol combination is recommended if that is not contraindicated. Regarding the convalescence period in the uncomplicated groin hernia, physical activity of patients should not be restricted. They should be allowed to resume normal activity as soon as possible, mostly 3 to 5 days most of the patient took. Mortality in the elective, regarding the mortality in the elective setting, mortality is very, very rare in the groin hernia. Mortality are there when the patient is having severe medical comorbidities and when they are presenting in the emergency obstructed or strangulated hernia. A word about the female and femoral groin hernia. As we know, femoral hernia is 4 times more common in women, and chances of incarceration and strangulation is more in femoral hernia. And grade A recommendation is given for female having groin hernia for laparoscopic approach. Timely hernia repair with the mesh is recommended in the female because suture repair is having very high recurrence rate. Regarding the recurrence hernia, as we know, recurrence rate worldwide is too high despite the numerous innovation in the groin hernia surgery. And we know near about 20 million groin hernia repair is performed worldwide, and recurrence rate is as high as more than 15%. The recommendation given is we need to choose a virgin plane, like if recurrence is after anterior repair, we should choose the posterior approach, laparoscopic repair. If recurrence is after lap repair, then we should go from anterior approach. And when the recurrence is after anterior and posterior repair, that the treatment is depend upon the patient's and surgeon's factor. So in conclusion, this hernia surgery guidelines given by hernia surge is the most voluminous work for the treatment option for groin hernia. It answers most of the question in our mind, and it provides us with an up-to-date knowledge and useful, which is useful for better outcome in the groin hernia surgery. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Rakesh. I think we will leave the Q&A till the end. But you can check the Q&A box, Rakesh. I think there are some questions for you as well, and maybe you can answer. So I think the third speaker is myself. I will talk on mesh technology. Let me just share my screen. Okay. And here you go. Okay. So first, I want to thank Sujit for helping me with the slides. Especially with the updates. So mesh is actually a very interesting topic because we find that more and more companies are getting involved in mesh. And we find that there are newer products always in the market. The reason is very simple. The cost to produce a mesh is very low and the margin for profits are very high. So it's a very attractive business model for anyone who is interested in the medical industry. So, and even a slight difference, a small percentage in terms of outcome, in terms of pain, or in terms of recurrence, or in terms of duration, or in terms of, discomfort. Even if you show a small change in these parameters, the newer technology will be adapted by many surgeons. So it's a very attractive business-driven entity. This is why you have so much of it. So do we actually need prostheses? The answer for this is obviously yes, because if we artificially produce tissue of density and toughness of fascia and tendon, the secret of the radical cure of the hernia wound would be discovered. And this was mentioned by Bill Roth in 1878. And we can see that from long-term RCTs, the usage of non-mesh techniques and mesh techniques, we can see that there is a huge difference in terms of recurrence and highly favorable towards mesh-orientated techniques. And this can be seen particularly in ventral hernia. If you don't use a mesh and you only do tissue repair, the recurrence rate can go up to 63%. Okay, so the use of prosthetic mesh has emerged as superior to other techniques in reducing post-operative pain as well as recurrence. So now a mesh repair is established as a standard technique, and it is also a technique which we teach most of our trainees. Now, many of us, or many of you listening to this, would wonder why do I mention this? You know, why do I stress so heavily that mesh is now a standard technique? Because, you know, when I began doing hernias a while ago, actually there was a lot of surgeons who were not doing mesh, and they were against doing mesh as well. And now this thinking has changed. So it is not something that automatically occurred. It went through the process of being accepted by the naysayers and then subsequently being adopted as standard procedure. So what about these techniques that we know, Bassini repair, the McVeigh shoulders, you know, should they just be kept to history? And then now we have Desada and newer non-mesh techniques. Should they just be, you know, neglected and things like that? The answer seems to be yes, if you look at literature. But if you are in a hospital that doesn't have a mesh, obviously then you have to adopt some non-mesh technique to serve your patients rather than just say that you are unable to perform the procedure. So if you have the availability of mesh, then obviously mesh is the option. If you don't, then obviously you need to choose one of these techniques. So we can find that the two most common inguinal hernia repairs remain the laparoscopic and the Liechtenstein's repair. Both are mesh orientated techniques. And as we know, Liechtenstein's now is one of the more popular techniques. And in fact, surgical clinics are open all around the world using the same name, and techniques adopted with this repair have been replicated. So what are the improvements in hernia repair? Well, you have got the introduction of prosthetic biomaterials, which is mesh, which has given rise to easier and easier tension-free repairs and better abdominal domain with mesh incorporation. Obviously, with the inclusion of laparoscopy, they also provide less infection, less blood loss, easier post-operative stay and things like that. So this would be a good MCQ question. It'll come out. So please have a good look at it so that you'll know. So a good mesh would be something that is chemically inert, non-carcinogenic, resistant to mechanical strains, capable of being fabricated and capable of being sterilized. I think I just want to have a mesh that is easy to handle. That would be the main criteria for a surgeon, actually, whether it's easy to handle when you're doing the repair laparoscopically. So as you all know, Giulio Natta won the Nobel Peace Prize in Chemistry in 1963. He died actually a few years after this with Parkinsonism. And not many people know this, but a lot of his creations were named by his wife: isotactic, hypotactic, and things like that. A very common problem that I think all of us have, actually. Okay, so as you know, we have got the history of mesh. You know, we have began in the 1950s with polypropylene woven, and now we are moving more and more towards ECPTFE and polyester. So whatever mesh you use, without understanding the anatomy and the pathology of the hernia, if you just plug it there, most likely the repair will fail. So mesh is not the answer to a hernia. It is mainly an adjunct. So despite having the 70, 80 mesh available in the market, it is very interesting to note that the outcome of the hernia will still depend on the understanding of where the hernia is and the mechanics of how it happened and how we are going to repair it. So if you want to look at mesh, they can be classified according to pore size, weight, and special characteristics. And you've got six classes of mesh. Class one is the large pore meshes, which is not very much used by many of us. We use more of class two. The class three ones are meshes with special features to prevent adhesion. The class four ones are meshes with films. Many of us use them for our ventral hernias. Class five, our 3D meshes, and class six are our biological meshes. So type one are large pore meshes, totally macroporous. Examples are polypropylene, relatively infection resistant, less chance of seroma, excellent tissue incorporation, but they tend to shrink following tissue ingrowth. And you've got a lot of type 1 meshes examples like that you can see here. I think the one that I have seen the most common in Malaysia is thigh mesh. Now, what about the other? You have got type 2, which is a microporous, a very small pore mesh, and it actually has got low adhesion formation. It's susceptible to infection, however, and it is prone to more seroma formation. Now you have got newer meshes using alloplastic material, the EPTFE. Of course, they are more expensive and their benefits remain to be seen with more and more detailed studies. You've got type 3 meshes, which are microporous with multifilamentous or microporous component. And these ones mainly are meshes that are susceptible to infections, but they are quite good because they are very easily malleable, for example, SurgiPro, and they are very easily manipulated, especially in the abdominal cavity. So they are quite popular because of this feature. Your type 4 are your biomaterials with submicron pore size using bovine or pericardial membrane and things like that. Very rarely it is used because the cost is so expensive. And of course, you have got the biological meshes, which basically are acellular extracellular matrix materials derived from humans or animals. And it is the indication to use biological meshes are very, very specific. So the drawbacks are there are not much clinical trials regarding biological meshes. There is a host reaction. You don't know whether an occult viral disease will or will not occur. High recurrence and the cost involved. Now, you've also got fully resorbable meshes now that repairs, remodels, and restores. And this is a commercial preparation that is coming into the market. And we may see more and more of it in time to come. The truth is, the current meshes are over-engineered for their intended purpose. It is like a car that is just supposed to drive, but now you've got a car that can drive, make coffee, put you to bed, and give you a shower at the same time. It is over-designed actually for its actual purpose to just strengthen the abdominal wall or to repair that particular hole you have. So it is very difficult for us now to actually go back to what the mesh is actually intended for. And we have to understand that mesh repair are not without complication. You know, you have got some meshes that produce excessive foreign body reactions, disorganized collagenous growth, scar plate formations, all kinds of complications. And if you do hernia long enough, you will be able to see these complications come and see you. And I can tell you there's nothing more challenging than to manage a patient that has got a complicated mesh to remove and also to sort out the problem. Mesh contraction is also an issue. You can find that mesh contraction contributes to, in some cases, almost 38% of the original size. All right. So we have more than 150 different meshes, and I believe that they are more than enough in the market. And for laparoscopic surgery, you have got also devices that aid in easy deployment of the meshes. So the problems with meshes will always be, you know, foreign body reactions, pain, recurrences, and also it causing intra-abdominal adhesions. So now we are moving towards, I believe, lightweight and macroporous meshes. And these meshes are easier with better flexibility, less shrinkage, and there's very little in bridging of the scar. And lightweight meshes actually are more easily malleable. And I think that technology is moving towards this. And we will find that more and more of these lightweight meshes will come into the market. So in summary, I think we have to realize that when we're talking about mesh, use whatever is available in your hospital. And when you're dealing with mesh, less is always more. So don't be so concerned about thigh mesh or, you know, about titanium mesh or whatever mesh. Be more worried about just using a mesh repair. Thank you very much for your kind attention. And if there are any questions, I'll be able to take them.
I think Sajid is back.
Good. So can we maybe put Sajid back on? Sajid, are you here?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, so let's go back to anatomy and pathology, Sajid, right? Of hernia. Please, Sajid, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Kufur. I'm sorry for interruption of the unstable internet connection on my side. After a brief introduction and the groin anatomy and the inguinal canal, I was talking about the structures passing through the canal. There is not much difference between the male and the female, except for the spermatic cord and the round ligament of the uterus. And I was talking about the laparoscopic groin view. Actually, the operating surgeon, as I was saying previously, Mr. Little has said, just repeating his words, the operating surgeon knows little of the posterior wall of the inguinal canal, so well is it hidden from his view. So when you are inside the abdomen, there are a lot of structures in the groin area, which needs to be identified before starting any dissection for inguinal hernia repair. So the peritoneal landmarks, which should be identified first of all, if you are doing a tap repair, identify the 5 peritoneal folds. In the central is a median umbilical ligament, laterally has a medial umbilical ligament, and the lateral most of the lateral umbilical ligaments. And there are the 3 flat fossas as well, the fossa lateralis, medialis, and the vesicalis, which are respectively for the indirect hernia, indirect hernia, and for the suprapubic hernias. So what are these landmarks actually for? They are helpful for the localization of hernia. Either it could be a direct hernia, indirect hernia, obturator hernias, or supravesical, or the femoral hernias. So the first thing, if you are doing a TAPP approach, is the identification after the identification of this peritoneal fold. The next step is to identify the iliopubic tract, which is highlighted as a white line, which is actually the location of the inguinal ligament. So the structures above it and the structures below it are very important, because if there is any defect on the upper of this, just above to this line, would be a direct or indirect hernia, and below are the triangles of the doom and the pain and the death triangle, as well as the femoral hernia. So here you can see in the picture onto the right side, the location of the indirect hernia and the femoral hernia according to the iliopubic tract. The preperitoneal space, which is, if you are going to do either TAP approach or a TEP approach, the first thing which you will do is enter into the two layer of the fascia transverse cellus, which is the superficial and the deep layer. If you can have a look into the deep, into this anatomical, this picture, just behind this red line, this one on this back line, in the black color, this is the superficial and the deep layer of the fascia transverse cellus. So if you are doing a TAP approach, so superficial and the deep layer of the fascia transverse cellus should be identified like this. And in case of TEP approach, when you are in an extra in a TEP approach, so superficial and the deep layer of the fascia transverse cellus should be separated accordingly. Because if you will go just above or just below, the chances of injury to the vascular and the neurological structures would be high. So the first, after identification of the peritoneal folds, if you are doing a TAP approach, and in case of TEP approach, identification of the superficial and the deep layer is very important. The second thing is, the next thing is the transition of the deep layer of the fascia transverse cellus into the spermatic sheath. As you move forward, the deep layer of the fascia transverse cellus will move on, and it will be starting covering the deep layer of the fascia transverse cellus will be covering the spermatic sheath, and it will continue with the urogenital sheath as well. The spermatic sheath is wrapping the cord structure as well as the urogenital structures. The spermatic sheath is cut anterior to peritonize the hernia and the hernia sac for the identification of the anatomical structures. And I will just omit this slide because first let me introduce show the vessels. The next anatomical structure is the vessels in the preperitoneal space. The landmark in the preperitoneal space is in the inferior epigastric artery, which is running on the top. Because you have to identify, you have to follow the inferior epigastric artery, but not to nude it, because if you are nuding it, it means that you are bringing down the superficial layer of the fascia transversalis, and chances of injury to the vessel would be higher. So the epigastric vessel, which is just after the reduction of the peritoneum with deep layer of the fascia transversalis, you can see into the left diagram, and into the right diagram, it could be deviated in any other in opposite direction. In case of right inguinal hernia, you can see the epigastric vessel is dislocated medially by a large lipoma. So area of caution is then in case of when you are identifying the vessels, if you can see this triangle of the pain and the triangle of doom, which carries the nerve and the vessels respectively. So I will go into the triangle of doom first. So if you do a dissection into the fascia transversalis, staying between the the superficial and the deep layer, so there will be a lot of structure which would be visible like this. But if you look on the top of this triangle of the dome, the iliac artery and the iliac vein are constituting the content of the triangle of the dome, with the testicular vessels and the vas deferens making its boundary. Here you can have it. The next thing is the corona mortis as well, which is present in almost 30 to 35% of the patients. And it is actually formed by the at the confluence where the inferior epigastric as from the top and the internal iliac from the down are conjoining. And these are the short branches which are communicating with these two. Because any injury to this area at the corona mortis will lead to a bleeding from the both end. If you will try to stop the bleeding from the top inferior epigastric artery, there will be high pressure bleeding from the down. And if you will try to stop bleeding from the downward, there will be a bleeding from the top as well. And another network of the pubic vein, which is present in this area, is the network of the pubic vein, which is protected by the deep layer of the fascia transversalis. So the point is to stay between the superficial and the deep layer. Either you are using the TEP approach or the TAPP approach, the point is to stay between these two layers. Then comes the nerves. This is a picture I've taken from a book regarding on the cadaveric dissection and showing all the ideal vessels, starting from the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, genital femoral nerve, it's the femoral and the genital branches, showing all its branches. But this is not a constant anatomy. Remember, there is a variation in the anatomical structures as well as the vascular structures into the anatomy. As I mentioned, the corona mortis in 30 to 35% of the patients, and the same is true with the nerves as well. So you can have, sometimes there are the two branches of the genitofemoral nerve, there are sometimes there are three, and sometimes there is only one branch of the. So the point is to not to expose these nerves, rather exposing is, or if you will try to expose any of the nerve, if you will try to identify the nerves, the chances of injury to these nerves would be higher. So if you can look here, nerves are protected by the deep layer of the fascia transversalis. You can see the two branches of the cutaneous lateral femoral nerve. And again, if you will try to expose the nerve, if you will try to expose the deep facial nerve, so chances of injury would be higher. And either it could be only one branch or three branch or four branch. Don't go into the detail. Don't try to locate the nerves by exposing by nuding the fascia and by removing the deep layer of the fascia transversalis. The next is then is the myopectineal orifice of the fracture. So if you consider it like a clock, and then at the deep ring, divide it like a 12 o'clock position, 3 o'clock position, 6 o'clock position, and 9 o'clock position. So the structures between the 12 o'clock and the 3 o'clock would be the place for the indirect hernia. The structure between the 3 o'clock and the 6 o'clock would be your area of triangle of the dome and the triangle of the pain and the dangerous triangles. And the area between the 6 o'clock and the 9 o'clock position is the location for the identification of the femoral hernia. And the area between the 12 o'clock and 9 o'clock is the place for the direct hernia. So, and try to avoid the nerves for the prevention of the inguinal hernia. As I mentioned, that the nerve damage during the dissection, nerve irritation from the mesh, nerve injury from the fixation. So any attempt to expose the nerve can lead to the inguinal hernia. It will expose the nerve either by the dissection, either neuropraxia or nerve irritation by the mesh, or injury by the fixation can lead to the this post-operative complications. So once you have completed your dissection, the structures would be like this. There are a lot of structure which should be visible. On the top, there should be an inferior epigastric vessel. And onto the right side, there should be a pain triangle and the dangerous triangle and the femoral ring onto the left side and the Cooper's ligament. So after the complete dissection, you can identify all these anatomical landmarks. The second step is the classification. Dr. Rakesh, I've already mentioned about in detail regarding the classification system by giving an example as well. So I will just omit this. I will just show a couple of slides. If there is a groin hernia classification system, the point is, is it necessary to always classify the inguinal hernia? The recommendation is weak, but if you want to describe your research, your artwork and your the numbers, then you have to identify, you have to present all the classification according to the numbers. So it would help into presenting the performing research as well as for the good quality audits. So Dr. Rakesh have already mentioned about it, so I just omit these slides. So in conclusion, I can say that understanding the posterior anatomy is crucial to outcome, and understand the preperitoneal space, nerve recognition and careful dissection of the myopectineal fossa is a key for the prevention of the pain and the recurrence. And remember again, this slide is very important, because once you have completed the dissection, before the placement of the mesh, let me show one more slide here. Sorry, I forgot to enter this at the end, this one. So once you have done your dissection, you can see into the extreme left picture. So your preperitoneal space should be communicating with the retroperitoneal space. Otherwise, there will be a chance of the recurrence of the hernia, because the peritoneal fluid will be moving below to the mesh and it will lead to the recurrence. So once your dissection is completed, all structures, including the peritonization of the hernial sac, identification of the iliopectineal line, myopectineal orifice, everything should be visible right in front of you. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks, Sajid. So I think we move on, because we are fighting for time. So our next speaker will be talking on TAPP, and it will be none other than Dr. Vimal K. Vasudevan. He is the president of the Society of Laparoscopic Surgery in Malaysia, SELSMA, and the Malaysian Hernia Society, and also the governor for Malaysia for ELSA. So without further ado, Mr. Vimal, please could you present your talk on laparoscopic TAPP?
Thank you, Gafur. You're able to hear me and see my slide?
No problem, boss.
Okay, thank you. First of all, thank you to the ELSA Outreach Program coordinators for inviting me to give a talk. My talk will be on laparoscopic TAPP. So I will get straight into it. The instruments you need for laparoscopic transabdominal, preperitoneal, or any laparoscopic hernia surgery are almost the same. You just need basic instruments like a 30-degree telescope, 5 or 10 mm. You need a bowel grasper in case you need to reduce the bowel content from the scrotum. You need some straight graspers, scissors. Okay. So normally I would like to make my surface anatomy. The most important points are your transumbilical, midline, and both mid clavicular lines. I also like to draw out the lacunar ligament from outside and the position of the hernia. My trochas are 2 5 millimeter trochas, and optic trocha is a 12 millimeter. I always give a local anesthetic prior to incision. So my first stroke is always my pneumoperitoneum is I. I did 2 clicks, water testing, you know, and then the next one. So the pressure I keep is 12 millimeters of mercury. Yeah. So once the ports are inserted, they will look like this in the same line of the transumbilical line. Okay. If you usually they say if you are doing a right side, the surgeon stands on the left, and the right side troca is about 2 centimeter higher than the transumbilical line. The left side troca is a bit lower, but it's good to place it all in the same line as though you're going to do bilateral, because you would have taken consent for bilateral, keep in view. And suddenly if you have a bilateral and then if you not adjusted your troca properly, then you will be in trouble. So it's good to learn to do it in the same line. Okay, so the surgeon normally stands on the area opposite of the hernia. So if it's the right one on the left, left one, left side on the right. Yeah, okay. So it's on the opposite side. The monitor is usually at the foot end. Your assistant cameraman is can stand opposite you, behind you, or sit down beside you. Okay. So this is how the position is, the cameraman holding and me operating. We stand side by side. And the patient usually needs a head down position so that the small bowel in the pelvic cavity can fall backwards and your groin is exposed for you to do a transabdominal preperitoneal surgery. So I usually start by making an incision from the anterior superior iliac spine to the medial ligament across the inferior epigastric. Once I reach the medial ligament, I will cut about 1 to 2 centimeter vertically along it, and 1 to 2 cm below the toward the ASI, the ASIS. This initiates a lazy S incision, allows you to see the structures in the posterior wall, as well as the structures in the medial and medial compartment. Okay. So the dissection normally for beginners, I will divide it into lateral dissection, medial dissection, and central dissection. So lateral dissection being from the ASIS to the spermatic vessel, wherein the end point of the dissection is to see your psoas muscle and possibly the two nerves which lie along it. Okay. Has been described just now. Sometimes it is not necessary for you to look for the nerves. That's very important. If you see fat overlying your rectus muscle and lateral, the area lateral to it, means your nerves are safe. You don't have to look for it. Once I'm done with that target, I'll move on to the medial aspect. So normally I grab hold of the medial ligament and then create a space between in the medial compartment and start doing dissection in the space of radius. Okay, so your target is to show the symphysis pubis, the lacunar ligament, pubic tubercle, and as medial as seeing the corona mortis sometimes. So you must be aware when you're doing a direct inguinal hernia, you will encounter a direct sac here. So you must get as medial as possible to the sac and then start to reduce the sac, okay? Then we come to central dissection, wherein we have to dissect, if it is an indirect hernia, you have to dissect the sac from the spermatic cord structures, which is the vessels and the vas, okay? Just like in open surgery. So once you have done that, then you do posterior dissection along the posterior wall until you see the vas moving medially towards the bladder, roughly about 3 to 4 centimeters posteriorly, because in the triangle of doom and pain, you cannot fix the mesh. You can just apply it. So you need the weight of the bowel to press on the mesh so that it doesn't crumple. Okay. So that some things regarding the sac. If it is a very long, large sac, especially indirect hernia, you may need to transect it. Okay. In direct sacs, normally you can reduce it. Okay. Very rare direct sac, you need to transect it. Okay. But direct sacs in a direct hernia can form seroma, even indirect sac. So some people have gone on to tag the pseudosac or the transversalis fascia to the lacunar ligament or suture it like a TAPP plus technique. And always ensure hemostasis before you put a mesh. You don't want a hematoma there causing a seroma or worse still bruising and possibly post-op infection of a mesh. Okay, the dissection usually about 1 to 2 cm medial and lateral, okay? And maybe above the lacunar ligament, about two to three centimeter above the defect, about 3 to 4 centimeter below the defect. Okay, so I'll show you a video. Okay, so this video shows you the, I point out to the medial ligament, the direct hernia, okay? You can see the inferior epigastrix there, so it's definitely a direct hernia, okay? Then we start the incision. You place your finger externally at the anterior superior iliac spine, push it in. So you see the indentation and that's where you start. So first you make peritoneal incision from the anterior superior iliac spine, okay? Taking care to stay just beneath the peritoneum, okay? It's very important. Don't start cutting into the fat layer and all, then you'll start getting a lot of bleeding. Stay very close to the peritoneum. Then you extend it laterally downwards so that you can view the psoas muscle easily. And then go back to your dissection. Stay close to the peritoneum. Small, small, like that, additions you can burn with diathermy. Minimize the use of diathermy. If you are in the right plane, you'll always be able to strip away tissue rather than burn it away. So when you reach the reflection of the peritoneum at the groin, you can strip it posteriorly and then you can see the beginnings of your psoas muscle, you can see there. Okay, so laterally, if you start, you see that's the fascia, just now was being described and you can see the branches of the nerves, 1, okay, and 2, okay. And you can see you have reached the iliacs there. Then we go medial. Okay, once you hit the somatic vessel, you have finished your lateral dissection. Now we are doing medial dissection. Okay, the target is, this is the direct hernia, you have to go medial to the sac. This is the space of the radius dissection. Okay, so if you are in the right plane, it doesn't bleed at all. You are pushing the bladder down and you are pushing the fascia up. Okay, so your target is to see the symphysis and then work all the way medial to it. Okay, you can see the inferior epigastric. So that's the sac between the inferior epigastric and your lacunar ligament there. So always take your time to ensure hemostasis. It's very important. Minimize blood loss. You may have very elderly patients who are on, you can see the pseudosub sac there. You have to push it back into the sac, hernia cavity. So once you found the pubic bone, dissect about 2 to 3 centimeter inferior to it. So that's where you're going to place your mesh. So part of your surgery is to reduce the hernia. Part of it is to prepare the bed of the hernia to place an appropriate mesh, which has been advised to you by Dr. Ghafoor. So the mesh has to lie flat across the medial compartment, the central compartment, and the, So once I have done that, I put a gauze in, I ensure hemostasis. Then I will change my glove because now I'm going to handle the mesh. So appropriately, ideally the mesh should enter from the packet into the patient. Okay, so that's the concept. So that you reduce risk of people handling it and reduce the risk of infection. It's an implant after all. So to ease the usage of the mesh, I always roll it into half and then put a knot in the center and then roll it fully. Because to me, half a mesh is easier to handle than a full mesh. Okay, so the next is placing the mesh in the area of your dissection. Okay, and then fixing the mesh, making sure you fix. There are a few areas where you cannot fix. You can fix on the lacunar ligament, anywhere anteriorly, medially, superiorly, avoid the inferior epigastric and laterally. Do not, like just now was mentioned, from the 3 to 6 o'clock position below, do not, 3 to 9 o'clock position, inferior to that posterior wall, do not tack. Very dangerous. You depend on the bowel, okay? So these danger areas, avoid. Now, when you're closing the peritoneum, you have many options. Ideally, when you're starting, concentrate on your technique of dissecting. At some point, you have to learn how to suture the peritoneum because this will take you to the next step in your evolution as a laparoscopist. Okay, so hernia is an intermediate procedure. You don't want to be a herniologist only. You want to become a colorectal surgeon, an upper GI surgeon, and so on and so forth. So this is where you learn to do suturing. So don't avoid it. Okay, so the gauze which I put inside, I always place behind the bladder so that I know where it is and then I can take it out. It's very easy when you're new to forget what you left behind, you know. So mesh placement has to be flat. Okay, 3D is good. It confirms to the groin, but all you need is a flat mesh, not always a 3D mesh. Okay, of course, if you have the money, you can use 3D. Okay, then fix the mesh, any kind of fixation device. And then cut the suture in the midline, in the middle. The suture also guides you to where the inferior epigastric is. It's not a rule. It's just something we can use. Then unfold it and fix it at the medial most corner and one more tacker in between. Okay. So when you're doing a hernia, you make sure the medial aspect is at the pubic symphysis, okay? If you do open surgery also, you put the mesh medial aspect 2 centimeter medial to the tubercle. So rough estimate is the symphysis. Make sure your mesh does not crumple, especially inferiorly, okay? So don't leave behind lax mesh. You see, it should be, don't tack there. I'm just showing, not tacking. So your mesh should sit nicely and then you can tack the peritoneum. So at the end of the surgery, release all the pneumoperitoneum and close the abdominal wall. Any suture incision more than 10 mm needs a fascial closure. 5 mm just skin closure. Okay, so the advantages of TAPP, you can use it to diagnose, you can use it in incarcerated hernias, okay, sliding hernias, and also to assess the contralateral groin. Okay, as we know, there is a fair amount of incidence of contralateral hernia as well. Okay, also to me, to get used to the abdominal cavity, you have to be inside and be comfortable with it. Then you can progress on to colorectal, GI, and bariatric, and all those things. Okay, so it also reduces your learning curve for TEP. Okay, learning curve for TEP is more than for TAPP. So basically, it's get out of jail if there are TAPs. Okay, so preparation catheter is optional only. Very old people or have a recurrent surgery. Okay, if you have lipomas, you should remove. Okay, seroma is a problem. So you must advise patient before surgery. If you have a serum, large sac, please prepare them. You say after surgery, you may get a seroma, and what is a seroma and how it will be managed. This is more important than getting it and the patient not knowing that it could happen. Because to them, they came to you with a swelling, and after surgery, they come back to you with a swelling. They always assume it's a hernia. Okay, so you must explain to them the concept of seroma before surgery. Okay, so some people use this eversion of a transversalis fascia to reduce the risk. Some people close the defect, direct defect, to reduce the risk. Okay. Mesh, I think Dr. Gafu already covered. Port set closure is necessary if 12 mm. Okay. Ambulation, physical activity restrictions are not necessary. Normally, we can tell them your hernia or the pain will limit what you can and cannot do. So, of course, if you are a professional sportsman, heavy work, manual laborer, then normally we have to wait for a couple of weeks. Okay. So that's it. Thank you very much. I shall stop sharing.
Thank you, Mr. Vimal, for that nice talk on TAPP. Maybe we'll just take a quick question since we have time. We have a question from Paul that says that he thought tacking is out of favor and most use glue. What is your opinion, Mr. Vimal, on that?
Okay. There are many trains of thought. Tacking is not outdated. Since I have known it, it all started with the non-absorbable tackers. Okay, so then it went on to a few years back to absorbable tackers. So glue was always there, but it never gained popularity. Okay, people were not convinced that it had the burst strength or, you know, strength to hold to a mesh. So when do you use? If a direct hernia, I always fix. Okay. If an indirect hernia, small one, technically less than 2 centimeter defect, you don't have to fix. But most of us are more comfortable when we fix it. This is for TAPP I'm talking. Because you realize when you do a TAPP, the area of dissection is very large. And then when we put a mesh, often the mesh seems to be floating inside. So the concept is very uncomfortable to me as a surgeon. I always like to fix. Now, one of the problems cited for tacker use is post-op chronic pain syndrome, okay? The tacker causing damage and pain. So they say this can be reduced by using glue. Fair enough, possible. But there are also papers suggesting that glue also can increase the incidence of seroma. Okay, so the recommendation is try to, if you have to tack as little as possible. Okay, so usually for one mesh, you need about 2, 3, 4 to 5 areas of tacking for TAPP. So that should be enough. If you're not comfortable, then you can move on to glue. The price is about the same. Sometimes the glue doesn't have a good delivery device. So that's why it has never gained popularity.
I think technically also tacking somehow or other makes you feel much more secure that your mesh is there and it's going to stay there.
If you stay in the safe places, I think it's safe.
Yeah. Okay, so moving on, I think our next speaker is Dr. none other than Dr. Sujit, who spent a lot of his valuable time in helping to organize this webinar for ELSA OP, and he will be talking to us about TEP. Dr. Sujit is also working at the National University of Singapore Hospital, and currently he is posted to Alexandra Hospital, I believe. And he will deliver his talk on TEP, which I'm sure will benefit all of us. Dr. Sujit, please.
Yeah, thanks, Kafu. I also take this an opportunity to welcome Dr. Hiroshi Hirokawa. So he'll be joining us for the video masterclass. So he's one of the panelists now. Yeah. So welcome Dr. Hiroshi from Japan. So I'll share my screen now. So I think in terms of anatomy and all, I may skip most of these slides because Sajid has mentioned quite a bit, and then Dr. Vimal also mentioned quite a bit about the anatomy. The extraperitoneal plane anatomy is almost the same for TEP and PAPP, just the axis is slightly different. So I will speak maybe about 1 minute here. So what is the quadrangle of pain and doom? So the triangle of doom basically is a triangle bounded medially by the vas deferens. Laterally is bounded by the spermatic vessels, the testicular vessels, and then the peritoneal reflection is your base. And the structures that that traverses this triangle of doom is basically your iliac vessels, and your iliac lymph nodes are there. So the other triangle, when it comes to both TEP and TAPP, is triangle of pain. So your iliopubic tract together with the inguinal ligament forms one side of the triangle. The common landmark both triangles share is the spermatic vessels, so that separates the two triangles, and then the peritoneal reflection again forms the base of the triangle. So the cutaneous nerves and the femoral nerve basically traverses this triangle. So you need to avoid tagging mesh in these two triangles. So I think this is again anatomy. So I will go into details when we come to the videos. So the OT setup is what you can see here basically. When I do both unilateral and bilateral, I put my ports all in the lower midline. I think Prof. Lomanto also does the same. I basically learned from him the technique. So we put the ports in the lower midline. I know some surgeons prefer to put the middle port a bit lateral if they are doing the hernia on, say if they are doing a hernia on the right side, so they like to put the second port, the middle port, the foramen port slightly towards the left side to allow triangulation. But the midline port placement still allows a lot of freedom of movement, so it's not an issue. So recently I started using this bipolar instrument, which makes the surgery faster. It's called Bisect, it's from Irby. So we also, because of the COVID-19 situation, we use the smoke evacuators. So let's quickly go back to the OT setup to a different video. Then I'll come back to, okay. So I hope everyone can see this video. So we start with the subumbilical incision, and then we divide the, we open up the anterior rectus sheath, we retract the rectus muscle laterally, and then we identify the posterior rectus sheath. So at the level of the umbilicus, you can actually see the posterior rectus sheath. It usually disappears about 2 fingers below. And then we use a finger dissection, or you can use a gauze dissection to create the plane for the 10mm port. So once you put in the 10mm camera port, then you use the camera for dissection of the extraperitoneal plane. So we use the camera under vision, then we continue the dissection in the midline until we see the pubic bone. So what's special about TEP is that we start the dissection medially and then we move laterally. So the 5mm ports, as you saw earlier, I have put in under direct vision. And then after that, so this is continuing the dissection laterally. So if I move back a little bit, what you can see is the insertion of the ports. And if you can see further down, you can see the pubic bone for the space of the ears. So if you can see this video, OT setup is basically, I'm doing the right side hernia. So I'm standing on the patient's left side, and my camera person, my cameraman or the assistant, which is who is standing on the ipsilateral side of the hernia. Okay, and the TV is actually placed at the foot end of the patient. okay, and the cables which are coming from the insufflation tube, and the camera is connected to the TV, which comes from the foot end of the patient, and the rest of the cables all are connected to the site. So again, dissection medially, continuing the dissection medially. So I think that's more than adequate for OT setup. Later, if there's any questions, we can answer. So I'll go back to the slides. So I'll show a video of a male hernia repair, then I'll show a female hernia repair to see the contrast. So this is, as I mentioned, using the camera, we are doing the dissection. So space of rhesus, so the red, you can see the pubic bone. Then we are continuing the dissection laterally. You can see the inferior epigastric vessels. You can actually start seeing the peritoneum. Okay, that's the femoral vessels. That's the iliac vessels. Okay, so this is a femoral hernia in this patient. That's an obturator hernia that we have dissected out. You can see the iliac vessels pulsating. Yeah, and this is the peritoneal
reflection. You can make the video bigger. Is it on maximum D on your screen?
I think. Are you seeing half of the video or?
No. We're seeing the full thing, but there's a comment asking whether we can make it bigger. If we can't, then it's okay.
I think this is the max I can get. I'm sorry.
No worries. Thanks, Sujit. Thanks.
Yeah. Or maybe they are talking about the first video that I showed, the OT setup and all that. So that video I used to show the OT setup, and this video I will show the anatomy. So again, you could see here, I go back to this part, you could see that the technique is almost the same once you have created the plane. It's quite similar to the TEP technique. So this is a femoral defect, you can see, just lateral to the vessels. You can see the femoral defect quite nicely there. Yeah, so that's a femoral hernia. And this is a direct hernia on the right side in the Hasselbach triangle. Okay, and then that's the inferior epigastric vessels. Okay, then placement of the mesh is quite similar to what Vimal mentioned. So the lateral, some people may ask what are the extension of the dissection. So laterally, we go towards the anterior superior iliac spine, and that marks our limit of the dissection. And then medially, of course, there's no limit. If you're doing a bilateral hernia, but if you're doing a unilateral hernia, please try not to dissect the other side, because subsequently, if the patient develops a hernia on the contralateral side, it's going to be quite difficult to do a TEP repair. So tacking of the mesh, there was a question there in the group chat. So small hernia defects is not needed, but for large hernia defects, it is in the guidelines. So next, I think we will see a female hernia. So this is the 84-year-old lady with a partially reducible femoral hernia. So you can see the initial dissection is almost the same. So how it differs is in the males, we have a vast difference as well as the testicular vessels, and the peritoneal reflection usually adhere to the vast difference and we need to peel it off. In females, the peritoneal reflection is usually adhered to the round ligament. So that's the peritoneum you can see. So we are moving towards the ASIS, anterior superior iliac spine, bringing the peritoneum down. So I'm using this bipolar instrument called bisect. It makes it quite easy to do the dissection. And it's actually bloodless. So, okay, so step two is, so we dissect the peritoneum off at the deep ring. So this is called thinning out of the deep ring. In an indirect hernia, this step is very important. So we thin out the deep ring so that we could isolate the peritoneal reflection or the peritoneal sac or indirect sac very nicely. So this is again a femoral hernia. So as you can see, in males we have the vast difference. In females, we have the round ligament there. So we ligate the round ligament because it can bleed. And then we tack the round ligament into the Cooper's ligament, the distal end of the round ligament, which we tack. Otherwise, it tends to fibrose near the labia, and some of the patients can come up with a lump at the labia. So this is a dissection and the reduction of the sac. So pull using bowel graspers, the peritoneum side. The other side, you can use a heavy grasper. You can see quite nicely the femoral hernia defect. So you can see the anatomy very nicely here. The Cooper's ligament, the lacunar ligament, and then the inguinal ligament starts here and extends. Yeah. Okay, I think, so for pain control, we started using this new technique, which is infiltrating local anesthesia into the transversalis fascia, as well as around the the cutaneous nerves, but not into the nerves. So I think I will stop there. Later on, we can have a discussion on any key concepts. And I think Prof is waiting for his lecture, which is the last.
Yeah.
I'll stop sharing. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Vijit. So our last speaker is none other than Professor David Lomanto. I think he needs very little introduction. I think everyone in the surgical community will recognize Prof. David. And Prof. David has been spearheading the ELSA OP program for so many years, a good friend of Malaysia and everyone across Asia. And Prof. David will be talking about complications in relation to inguinal hernia repair.
Thank you, Ghafoor. Thank you, Sujit. Thank you, everybody. And also, well, let's welcome Hiroshi Hirokawa, a good friend from Japan. He will be our guest speaker next week. But it was so nice to join you. Hello, Hiroshi. How are you in Japan?
Hello. Nice to meet you. Great program.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us. Be ready for next in a couple of weeks' time, right?
Looking forward.
So. Yeah, great. Okay. Also, thanks to all the participants. We have a good number. And of course, Ghafoor and Sujit give me a very tough job to talk about complication because they know that I'm not a good surgeon, so I have a lot of complication. Thank you, Ghafoor. So, complication happen. Hey, unfortunately, when you do case, you can see here, you can have a mesh infection. You have seroma, you have intestinal obstruction, you have pain. There's a lot of complications that may happen during endolaparoscopic repair. So either TAPP, TEP, even open, of course. And why happen? I think because, as you see, when the speaker focus on the anatomy. Anatomy is quite different what we learn. The space is small, it's narrow. Sometimes because of recurrence of anatomy can be distorted. Sometimes when you have a large direct or indirect hernia may be more challenging. So there are several reasons. And of course, happen especially at the beginning because it's not an easy surgery to learn. You f- for open Liechtenstein, 5 cases are enough. For laparoscopic, maybe you need a bit more. Depends if you are supervised by an expert or not, but around 20 cases. Because you can see most of the complication up in the first 50%, 50 of your patient. So what is the trick? I think the first trick is to start to prevent your complication, to keep it lower. How? By choosing the right patient according to your expertise. If you are a novice, don't start with a case like this. Start with a simple case, like a small direct, small indirect hernia, familiar, thin patient, familiarize the space. Then you move on to more difficult case. What are the complications that are mostly related to the surgery itself? Of course, bleeding are the most common because epigastric vessels are there, so usually are not very, very, very major. Visceral, especially if you do TAPP, you are inside the abdominal cavity, your instruments are quite lateral, parallel to the bowel. If the gas, for example, lower down, you may have injury the bowel. Bladder, because the bladder is there, especially the elder patient that they have a bit of prostate, the bladder is not voided well, and you may have a complication. Let's see what are the percentage, about 5% overall. Not very high, but very high for a technique that should be 0%. The first thing, especially for TAPP, when you enter the trocar, you enter the trocar and the vision because you put it laterally to the umbilicus. So the epigastric vessel is there. So you must remember the path of the epigastric vessel. So this is the path, it's a graphic. Remember always 2 finger breadth from 2-3 finger breadth from the midline is a dangerous place. So use a transillumination. Other vessels that you may injure are the corona mortis that are on the pubic bone. Luckily, the dangerous injury of the iliac vessel, major iliac vessel, are very rare. For example, when you do either TAPP or TP, your dissection must be careful, especially along the path of the midline. As in this case, and do not panic. We are surgeons. Just compress, clip it, isolate. Don't panic, and put some clip to stop the bleeding. Another case here, same. This is during the TAPP. As Dr. Rimar said, go superficial. Don't go through the fat. Because if you keep closer to the peritoneum, your risk of injury are very, very low. You can see. And when you see fat, like in this area, remember that the vessel and the nerve are protected by fat. So if you go through the fat, you may injure the vessel that underneath, like in this case. Usually, consider the epigastric vessel are blood come from both directions. You need to clip both directions, not only one, like in a normal vessel, because it's an anastomosis. So you can go on and control it. This is a bit more challenging when you have blood because you dissect too close to the pubis arch, symphysis. You don't need to do, because there's a bone. It can be challenging. What are the tricks? Use a good diathermy, like herb, for example, or any, but use a spray mode. You use a gauze to compress. If you are in a worry, just use a gauze to compress. Fix your irrigation and suction, and then wait for a good way to handle the bleeding. You cannot use clip in this case. In this case, only compression, and change your diathermy machine to spray mode, and avoid very long, very short and quick. Most of the time you are able to do. In some other case, you need to use stay there for 15, 20 minutes to compress and try to hop. In case you consider that the crown of death vessel come from the top, so you can clip above the bone and stop to reduce the blood flow. It may happen. Yesterday, two patients, because sometimes patients are whole, they have a lot of fibrosis, because of a urinary infection, so on, you may end up with the injury. Another issue is patients with platelet. This is more today, many patients are on antiplatelet like aspirin or clopidogrel, Plavix, anticoagulant, rivaroxaban, warfarin. Even though you reduce it, they're still have an elongated time and they tend to bleed. What use? Use energy. Use energy. Use a good energy. You use most of the time, as Sujit showed, bipolar. We use the bipolar dissection for a clean. Avoid to dissect too much. Keep the dissection to the minimum. And don't do a very strong black dissection. Try to go through the surgical plane and keep your surgery very clean. As should be all the time. In this patient, you need to be very, very careful. We have reviewed 200 patients that we have published on surgical endoscopy. Stop or not stop the aspirin and clopidogrel doesn't change your risk of postoperative complication and the risk of rebleeding. So mostly the risk of rebleeding is because of your inadequate surgical dissection. So use good energy, bipolar possibly, that is the best, better than monopolar, and just do a careful dissection, very clean dissection. Okay, let's move on. A bowel injury happened, you can see, in a very, very low percentage. And what are the injury? Like in this case, it's a recurrent hernia. You can see during the TPP, the bowel was stuck. In this case, you need to be careful to traction the bowel during the surgery. In this case, the surgeon was not really, really careful. Maybe you should open the ring, the hernia ring, because the bowel was attached to the previous mesh. It was a cause of recurrence. So probably you should be a bit more careful in this case to handle the bowel if it's attached to the previous repair, or sometime to the previous repair, or the hernia, like in this case, is incarcerated. Injury to the bladder may happen, especially when you have a large direct hernia. There may be a sliding hernia, so it is always good to put large hernia elder patient a catheter, and. If anything happened, like in this case, you can see opening of the bladder, is quite simple. Huh? No need to worry, much better than a bowel injury. You can just put a catheter and then you just suture. As Dr. Vimal say, suture is a task that you need, a skill that you need to learn. There's no way that you can be a good surgeon without know how to suture. You see the surgeon here, went in the wrong plane, went in the medial side. He dissect all the bladder. This is a matter of experience, because if you do 100% of the time, you injure the bladder. Anyway, suturing, put a urinary catheter for 2 weeks and you will be safe. Sometimes for large direct sac, you can also mistakenly the vas deferens. In this case, the surgeon was thinking that the vas deferens was here on the medial side, while this one, the spermatic vessel, was thinking that this is a residual hernia sac. So he transected, and once he transected, he regret. So before you cut anything, you better be sure that your anatomy and landmark are there. So the vas deferens you need to identify, your spermatic cord you need to identify, otherwise you end up, like in this case, with the vas deferens in your hand. If the patient is old is okay. But if the patient is young, maybe a bit of trouble. In this case, I came in and I just suturing with the 5-0 polypropylene suture. Peritoneal tear, you need to close. This other patient, why? Because suturing, as Dr. Vivan says, especially when you do TAPP, is good. When you have TEP, if you have a breach in the peritoneum, you must close all the hole because the bowel can go through, especially because patients have a bit of ileus post-op. How to close? You can use, for example, large defect, you can use 1 or 2 endo loop. I prefer to do a suture with the V-lock. If you are not like in this case. If you are not familiar to suture in that, such a small space, you can still convert to TAPP, go inside the abdomen, and then you have a very better triangulation. But I must say today with the V-lock suture, you don't need to do a knotting, so it's quite simple and easy to do. For a small opening, you can still use hemolock, for example. You can still use a small hemolock for closing the defect. And that's all. I am sure you enjoyed the virtual reality video. Dr. Sujit show, you can have a nice view of outside, inside. Other complication of nerve injury. To laparoscopic, the nerve injury is very low because we don't dissect laterally. We mostly have a lateral cutaneous nerve and genitofemoral nerve. And today we don't use more metallic stapler, but we use absorbable stapler. So the risk of injury is very, very low. So be careful of the lateral dissection. Don't go beyond the lumbar fascia. Because the nerves are there, you don't need to look for nerves. So be careful, fix with precaution. So as my previous two speakers show, only four tacker are absorbable, are more than sufficient to fix your mesh. Because the anchoring point is the pubis bone and the bladder and laterally. So usually two on the pubis bone, one medially, one superior, and one lateral to the epigastric vessel are more than enough. Otherwise, like this patient, was not able to walk because he has more than 35 stapler. And of course, if you see here, is exactly where the lateral cutaneous genitofemoral nerve are. So we need to go in and remove all the stapler. The last complication is the one worrying more the surgeon is the recurrence. As you know, we are all perfect. We seldom have recurrence. But remember that even the best ship, and the Titanic was one of that, unfortunately, may sink. So recurrence is there when you practice. And why recurrence happen? Because most of the time, 80% of the time, this is my experience in doing recurrent hernia for posterior repair. I have about 22 cases, but this is 2 years ago. Last month I did 2 posterior recurrents. So I do almost 2-3 per month. Most of 80% of the time, posterior recurrence is because the mesh is not in a proper position, it's higher up. So the lower dissection of the peritoneal reflection is the key of success for a good repair because mesh must stay vertical. Dr. Rimal showed you a perfect positioning, must be 2 centimeters below the pubis bone, must go along the, sit on top of the iliac vessel, on top of the psoas muscle. So the mesh must be in the retroperitoneal space, not in the preperitoneal space. Most of the surgeons, they are afraid of the lower dissection, the lower part of the section of the myopectineal orifice. And when you have a medial hernia, close the defect in the TP plus, like we have shown. In this way, you have more. We also do now for the TP plus for inguinal scrotal hernia, for indirect defect, we try to reduce the size of the indirect defect to have better position of the mesh, and that's all. And try to cover up at least 2 centimeters medially for medial hernia, because mesh may shrink a bit, may reduce, and the recurrence is there. So this is my last slide. Be alert, be safe, and choose the right patient. And follow the technique. Don't try to invent any new technique because the technique for TP and TPP is very well standardized today. And join us for the July 15, where Professor Hiroshi Hirakawa will be our guest. We'll show TPP in Japan, and other video masterclass will be dedicated to different technique and procedure. Thank you very much. And I think I leave to Sujit and Ghafoor to lead the discussion.
Thank you, Prof. I think we have answered most of the questions on the Q&A live. We just have a few. Number one is specifically to you, Dr. Devi. Do you use glue or absorbable tackers? Which is your personal preference?
I do fixation selectively. For small hernia, usually I don't do, but I do for bilateral large hernia, more than L2, M2, I do fixation. I use distal glue mostly in patients with antiplatelet, anticoagulant. I don't use glue for fixation, even though it's a very good and valid method, but I personally don't use it.
And I think I open this to Rakesh. Rakesh, have you had an obturator nerve neuropathic pain post-op? And what are your opinions regarding it?
Well, before Rakesh reply, okay, Ghafoor, I want to let all the participants that we will launch the poll of the question. So in the meantime, they can take some time to do the MCQ. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I think while you're answering the MCQ, I think we can discuss this, the Q&A. So I think everyone can see the poll, I think. Yeah.
Okay, you just go ahead with the discussion. Huh?
Yeah. So anyone has this obturator nerve neuropathic pain post-op? I've not had one.
Yeah, I think in most of the cases, when we go for obturator fossa, what we found in most of the patients is the fat going into the obturator fossa. So most of the time we remove that fat, but without touching the vessel and nerve there. And when we place the mesh in the space of ridges, as per recommendation, we go 2 centimeters below the lower border of the bone. So, I haven't seen the obturator nerve neuropathy because we don't fix there. We don't mobilize much, but only thing we mobilize there is the fat, what we found most of the time there.
Thanks, Rakesh. I think a lot of questions are regarding post-operative seroma, you know. So maybe some of us can share our views regarding it. How do we manage it, and how our take is on that? So especially with regards to large inguinal hernias. So maybe Mr. Vimal, maybe you can give your opinion on how to manage these seromas when they occur.
Mute.
You are muted.
Okay. So to me, for seroma, anticipation and expecting it to happen is important, and educating the patient regarding the seroma and its cause of how it will behave. Okay, then when we need to interfere. So when you do that, if especially larger sac, direct or inguinal scrotal sac prone to form. So that is first. Prevention. Second, prevention and education. Second, during surgery, I do a few things. One, when I'm dissecting the sac from the transversalis fascia, I take care to use diatomy to burn a lot of the small vessels so as to not to bleed postoperatively into the sac. Also, there's some theory that there may be some lymphatics there as well, which can cause leakages. So I take care to burn it, especially when I'm reducing the sac from the transversalis fascia. Third, other option, which I don't routinely do, is tacking the transversalis fascia to the lacunar ligament. And fourth, to prevent, is to do the plus procedure where in a direct sac, especially David's group, I think they are closing the lumen of the sac. Okay, so this very rare. I think I've heard of people using drains for large hernia sacs. Okay, personally, I've done it once only, But I also have fear that it can cause mesh infection. The fear of mesh infection is more dangerous than the seroma to me. Thank you.
What about if it does occur? That means you already have a seroma post-op. Yeah.
Patient will come back and he will point to the swelling. Is that first fear is that whether patient he has got a hernia again. So you reassure him, see, this is what I told you about, and you have a seroma. So asymptomatic seroma, not tense, not reducing the mobility of the patient, we can leave it alone, reassure them and wait. If patient needs assurance, you can do an ultrasound and show it to them. Okay, so they will trust your judgment if you need to do an ultrasound and tell them. Tense seromas probably are different because patient is not able to go back to work. We assured them they can go back to work early, and it affects their quality of life in terms of work, intercourse, all these things. So you may resort to draining it. If you have to drain it, do it in a sterile environment, maybe in an operating theater, sterile conditions. This is my advice. Not in the radiology, under ultrasound guidance. You may introduce infection and have an infected mesh.
I agree, boss. I think the first line is always counsel, counsel, and counsel, because most of the time it just goes off on its own unless it's really, really big. There are some practices where some of them apply some weight over the inguinal region after they've done a big dissection, some pressure bandaging, over that site, and they leave it for a couple of days. I don't know whether it works. There's no literature to support it, but in my private hospital, it seems to be a practice with some of them who do. We seem to have questions regarding a lot of questions regarding choice of mesh. What sizes do you use normally? So, I would say the minimum that you should employ for a TAPP would be a 10 by 15. Is there any other views from the panel on whether it should be bigger, smaller, or how would you decide?
Any hernia less than 4 centimeter, I will go with your 15 by 10, but you may need to fix. More than 4 centimeter direct hernia, maybe you need bigger one. The area of cover should be medial. If it's a direct hernia, at least 3 to 4 centimeter medial coverage should be there. Otherwise, when the mesh shrinks and there is weakness of the wall, you are going to get further recurrence.
Agreed.
Practice of closing the defect actually reduces the recurrence, David.
Or the seroma.
We'll answer that. In the meantime, I think the MCQ is happening now. So can you all please take the MCQ, Paul? The first 10 MCQs, maybe we give another 5 minutes. Okay. Then we continue the discussion about TP plus. I think I have to thank Marilo. Marilo is with us now. Marilo has helped us to compile the MCQs. So thanks so much, Marilo. Yeah. So Vimal, regarding the TEP plus, we do it for large hernia. So one reason we started doing it because patients with this kind of big hernia tend to get mesh migration, meshoma, and then seroma and recurrence. So we pull, for a direct hernia, we pull the transversalis fascia, we suture it medially to the lacunar ligament, or we just suture it to the origin of the inguinal ligament. That's for direct hernia. For indirect hernia, or inguinal scrotal hernia, we leave a bit of remnant sac. So because we ligate and divide the sac, so we leave the remnant sac. Then we pull the distal remnant sac, and then we suture it lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. But for both conditions, it's very important. For indirect hernia, we should not suture inferiorly as well as laterally, because that's your cord structures as well as your triangle of pain. And for medial hernia or direct hernia, we should not suture laterally because that's where your triangle of doom is.
The other popular question that keeps popping up is injury to the inferior epigastric artery. I think, Prof. David, you were mentioning something about this a while ago. I think, I don't know, I think if you've done enough, you will hit the inferior epigastric, or you've done enough workshops, you will encounter a few of your person who's doing it, you know, will hit the inferior epigastric. I personally feel that it's not a very big issue. If you can...
Can I answer that?
Can, please.
Okay. So if you are a starting surgeon, you say you're working with a 0-degree scope on a hernia, the blood will shoot right at your telescope. Now you will get panicked as a young surgeon. So the answer to that long-term is to learn how to use a 30-degree so you can look at it from directions. So once you see the bleeding from directions, then you can think, because it looks dramatic, but it is not going to exsanguinate the patient immediately. Hold the bleeder with one hand, and then one of the trocha, the right side trocha or left side trocha, change it to a 10 millimeter, okay? It's inferior epigastric. So if just compression doesn't help, you can wait. It's artery, you know? Sometimes it just branches from the inferior epigastric. You don't have to go and clip the whole vessel. But in worst case scenario, you can clip the vessel up and down and that's it. Okay, if it is branches, it will stop by itself or you just have to clip the branches. So the most important thing is not to panic. It's just inferior epigastric, clamp it or put pressure on it and wait, just like any bleeding.
Do you advise the patient that in the future, they have to be wary about any abdominal procedures that they do?
You still have your superior.
I don't think there's a big problem. I think there's a fallacy that you had to advise the patient that, you know, if you go for a next procedure with a laparotomy, your anterior abdominal wall will die and things like that. I don't think it's true because you've got other branches as well.
Yeah. No, but they are not. There are a lot of vessels that supply the same organs, the same muscle. So these are the superficial ones, they are not the deep ones. So we must say, no need to panic. Because it's magnified view, first of all, at the end of the day, it's a 3 millimeter vessel. It's no bigger than 3 millimeter. You can have a couple of veins, one artery and 2-3 veins. The one of the branches that is always easy to injure is the one between communicating the right and left. It is just below the arcuate line. There is one vessel go across, and it may happen quite often. So it's a small bleeding. The only thing is the patient may have a bit of bruise post-op. But the rest, usually, compression, it works. But sometimes I saw also people, they do, they control, they ligate, then they dissect further, and they injure again. Then I say, okay, better you change job. Become a vascular surgeon.
We have a question on thigh mesh.
Interesting.
Yeah. What is your opinion on thigh mesh and whether or not it is, it answers all the questions that we are asking regarding what a perfect mesh should be? You know, Is that thigh mesh really the solution now to all our problems with meshes, you know? What do you think, Prof? I don't think so. Number one, this solution is too expensive.
They say it's the greatest technology because it's titanium coated. Actually, you can even use for ventral hernia because polypropylene is no raw. So it's quite okay. It's expensive technology. It's a wonderful mesh. The handling is very good. It's hydrophilic. It's not too bad. There are mesh technology today is at any level quite good. It's mostly surgeon preference. In my opinion, for laparoscopic, the handling is very important. how the mesh, if the mesh is too soft, the wriggle, then it's very difficult to deploy. It must have a bit of memory, not too much to be too rigid, but a bit of memory. Idea. I don't know, Rakesh.
Prof, sorry, can we put the second MCQ?
Yes, yes. Yeah. I'm going. Yeah. So and this call.
Okay. How many do we have total? We have 30.
The last one. This is the last series of 10. Please go ahead, do it.
Okay.
I also put the panelists on so you can have a look.
Okay.
Here, time mesh. I got nothing against it, but I think it is probably an overkill for a groin hernia. But the properties are such that it is ideal for a ventral hernia.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a quoted.
Yeah. And, the material is such that it's inert. So it seems ideal, but then I don't have experience of using it for a ventral hernia, and it's probably a bit expensive to use it for a groin hernia where you just need a simple flat mesh in the groin.
Is Dr. Hiroshi here, or has he left us? Ah, hi.
What is the practice in Japan in terms of mesh technology?
Yeah, Professor, could you give some input on this Thai mesh? What is your opinion regarding titanium coated meshes, you know, because
yes, I don't have any experience to use Thai mesh.
Right.
What is the mesh technology? What kind of mesh you use in Japan?
I always use a 3D light map, 3D mesh, or Basatex mesh by Cobidian.
Okay. 3D from Bat 3D. Or ADP2 from Cobidian.
Yeah, but in Japan, the 3D max light mesh was, many surgeons use 3D max light.
Okay.
Mm.
And there is size you use.
Yeah, Japanese patient is very small. The height is 140 to 150 centimeter.
But you don't. So, you are not. You are very tall.
My heart is 180, but sometimes the Japanese patient is more very small. For 2 years, 15 by 10 centimeter mesh for such a small patient is very tough. It is too big to use for such small patient. For such patient, I always use 14 by 10 centimeter mesh.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you use the 3D light small, then I think 9 by 13, 9.5, yeah.
But 3D mesh, the lateral point is very tapering.
Yes,
tapering. It's
bigger.
Yes, such mesh, I can use such mesh to the small patient because the lateral part is tapering.
Okay, that's great.
David, I wanted to know, do you have any experience with the triple neurectomy for chronic pain?
Triple neurectomy in open, yes. In laparoscopic, no. I must say that we have a very good protocol that is almost the international protocol for chronic pain that goes gradually from pain that we monitor after 6 months. If it lasts more than 6 months, it's the VA scale is above 6. We treat with the vitamin 12 and pregabalin. If no responding, we do nerve block. I do a nerve block. And if not, we refer for acupuncture. In most of the case, Sajid was there, in most of the case are quite okay, quite okay. I have a lot of patients operated outside. Lately I have patients operated, one in France, one in Germany, open, bilateral, with chronic pain. Acupuncture at the end was quite good. Most of the time, it's a psychosomatic pain. Mm-hmm. You see the patient a bit stressed and everything. So because when you do the test to do the location, no, to see which branch of the nerve is involved, the lateral cutaneous, the femoral branch, the genital branch, sometimes it's a specific. Yeah. So we usually we go to treat this process. An MRI, it may be useful. If you need to plan for surgery, if you are want to really be sure that there's a meshoma or there is a nerve entrapment, MRI is very, very good.
What do we look for in the MRI?
Oh, you can if the MRI is properly done, they can look at the path of the nerves. They can individualize the nerve and they can see a granuloma, for example, around the nerve. It means there's a suture. A triple neurectomy is good, but it gives you a very big area of numbness. So you need to counsel the patient very well. Because they will have a very big area of numbness after that. That not everybody. So I think in terms of protocol, pregabalin, vitamin B12, wait until really the patient beg you. We do nerve block at the SIS. You can do ultra ultrasound guided nerve block. And the last will be acupuncture, last option. And the option that is the end will be, if it's done posterior laparoscopic, a diagnostic lab and removal of the stapler, if they are metallic stapler. Mm. But if you are not metallic stapler, it's absorbable, very difficult.
Yeah, you can't find.
Yeah, so that's why.
Taking out the previous mesh.
MRI, specific MRI for soft tissue is very good.
Okay, thanks.
Well, there's some questions about bleeding from corona mortis.
Vimal can answer.
Excuse me. I think that the definition of the chronic pain is unclear. Because there is some patient who complain discomfort, very little patient complain pain, which limit their life. So for the chronic pain, the definition of chronic pain is very unclear. I always have hesitated to think what is the chronic pain.
Yeah, it can be nociceptive pain. So it must be a pain that is located, it should be at rest, not all at movement, and should be along the path of the nerves, because it can be due for many other reasons. You need to also exclude that it's not hip-related joint pain, it's not the inguinal ligament distraction pain, pubalgia. So that's why MRI is one of the important things to exclude, that there is a concomitant pathology. It's mostly by exclusion. So that there is no joint pain, no hip pain, no articular pain, no ligament strain pain. So that's also important to exclude. You need to exclude almost everything before you go and treat it. And then you must be able to find to identify a cause that can be a suture, that's why I believe that MRI, not so soon, but after all the medical treatment fail, it may be useful.
Prof, can you put out the second part of MCQ again? I think there's some.
It's already on. It's already on the second part of the MCQ.
But this one participant says.
Oh, this means the MCQ number one. Okay, I can do. Let me finish the MCQ, the second 10 MCQ. We keep for 10 minutes. We almost have 652%, as you can see. And after that, we will launch for a couple of minutes the previous one. Any other discussion? So what is your attitude? What is the attitude for the chronic pain in Japan, Hiroshi?
In my hospital,
is very common or not?
Oh, no. I think there is not so many chronic pain patients. I have no chronic pain patient after my surgery. But
yeah, for laparoscopy, it's mostly the lateral dissection.
I think so.
But for open surgery, it's quite common. It's about 4 to 5%.
5%. Laparoscopic and open procedure is 5%. 50 to 50 in Japan.
Laparoscopy is very low, right?
No, about 45% procedure is laparoscopic procedure in Japan.
No, oh, not too bad. Very good. Yeah. No. I say chronic pain. Chronic pain after laparoscopic
chronic pain
is low.
Not so high. Very low. I think chronic pain is very low in Japan. But I think the patient, some patient complain discomfort, not pain, discomfort. So
I cannot relaunch the poll, Sujit. Mm. Oh wait. Relaunch the poll like existing. Do you want? No, I cannot because otherwise I need to cancel everything.
Okay, then I think it's fine. I think this one
can maybe so
maybe we ask him to email us, Sujit, and then we can just send him the
Maybe we can just arrange on online poll. We make available online poll, because if I relaunch everybody, all the people who reply or answer, they will lost.
Will get canceled. Yeah. Then we will.
So for the people who haven't taken the MCQ, we will put online and we will email to you. They give us about at least 1 week time.
There's one last question here. Very interesting.
How long is it recommended to rest peritoneal dialysis post hernia repair? Very good.
Oh, we are doing a study actually on it because we are getting a lot of patients with the PD. There's no data on it.
Yeah.
So we are trying to work on a protocol with our PD. Usually we move to hemodialysis for 1 week, 2 weeks. And then we go back to PD.
So you stop the PD, then you do you hemodialysis. During that time, you do the repair, then you go back to PD.
Yes. This is for TP. For TAPP is a different.
Yeah. It won't be so easy, you know.
I suppose this is an indication for TEP or open surgery.
Yeah.
Usually for TP and very occasional, we have risk is mostly infection. They say pseudoseroma because it's the liquid of the, and or another choice, you can go on low volume PD. If you do TAPP, you can still do, but they can go on low volume PD, peritoneal dialysis. Yeah, but. Of course, if it's unilateral, better to do open.
Yes, yeah. I think so.
Just do open. But of course, more and more of this case today in a clinic, I got two patients with PD. Mm. Like one is inguinal scrotal.
Okay.
I will send to Sujit.
Right person for the job.
What would you do, Sujit?
Refer back.
Yeah, I will send to my best friend.
So?
No, I mean, inguinal scrotal depends whether it's actually completely reducible or whether it's partially reducible. So partially reducible inguinal scrotal or those hernia that is not visible at all, I try to get a CT scan to assess whether it is feasible to do endolaparoscopic repair. Otherwise, if it's those giant inguinal scotal hernia, open is a better option.
But the risk of recurrence with open will be higher, you know, with the PD and all that.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I will go by David's concept, you know, do a hemodialysis, do the repair, wait for 2 to 3 weeks, and then reinstitute.
I think it's feasible to do, so they can put a permanent catheter. Don't need to do a AV fistula.
They
can put a catheter, they can do something.
Can go up to
if the patient is there are some patients that still have a bit of urinary kidney function, they can go on low volume PD. They can do for 1 week, to even 10 days can do low volume PD.
But can you do TAPP?
Can do. If you close the peritoneum properly, you can do.
Yeah.
If you suture it. If you suture it properly, you can do.
That will be the peritoneum closure.
Yeah. I think if peritoneum 1 week, it will close up.
Yeah. The peritoneum 1 week will close up. You can use a glue, for example, spray glue on top. I think you can. You can learn TP, no problem.
Interesting.
Yeah. Time to learn again.
Okay. I think we have a good timing.
Yeah, that's nice. So, shall we conclude?
Yes.
Sujit, please.
Okay, so I think thanks so much for joining us. We had a fruitful time, good discussion points. I think all the questions has been answered. So thank you, all the speakers. And thank you, Marilu, for arranging the MCQ. And thanks, Prof and Elsa, for the opportunity. So we invite all of you to join us for the second session on 15th of July, which will be the video masterclass. So we will discuss more nice topics as well. I ask you to register for the session early. So with that, have a nice day, have a nice evening, and then hope to see you all on the 15th of July. Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye. Hey, bye-bye. Thank you. I'm stopping all these things, stopping recording, stopping things.